If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when the people rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us up alive. When their anger was kindled against us, then the flood would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us, and then over us would have gone the raging waters. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to be again in the house of our God. I'm missing something. Oh no, I have a bulletin right here. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome to Frankfort United Methodist Church.
Good morning. Good to see everyone this morning. I'm going to kind of let you read the things in the bulletin. AJ's still having his Bible study. Some of these things I just do not get discussion about. But I do have, Karen handed me this. If you're doing the school kits, the bags are on the altar. There'll be a few more coming in. I have fabric laying in my basement near my sewing machine. I don't want to get too quick, you know. And I did go to Walmart yesterday, and they have all their school supplies on sale. The only thing I noticed an increase in was the ring binders. And they're normally a quarter a piece. This year, they're 35 cents. But I got, so you can go to Walmart and get your, between picking up a bag and going and getting your goods, you're not even going to have $10 in one of these bags. And I don't know. I just think they're a neat thing to do, along with the shoe boxes. But these are back on the back table. Just pick up one so you can see what you need to put in there and things like that. And if you need AJ, he's got his phone number in here, and you can contact him that way. And I think that's all I have.
All right, now we'll turn to our praise song. We're using the hymnal, page 657 and page 601, but I did type out or make an attempt to type out the lyrics on the screen as well. So if you'd rather use the slides, you can do that. But let's stand.
Thank you.
The scripture is, I went to a church once and I preached a sermon, and the people came up to me after the message and said, "It's so good that you had us open our Bibles today." They said, "We don't normally do that," and I felt so sorry for those people because they had to listen to whoever their preacher was. I promise he was not as intelligent as the Word of God. That's why I focus so much. That's why there's so many scriptures. I have to apologize to Jim this morning. We're up over 70 slides for this sermon. Because most of them are just scriptures. Because the Word of God really is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And when we walk without the scriptures, we stumble in darkness. Some of us have walked in darkness for so long that we don't know it's dark anymore. If you're not spending time in the scriptures every day, your soul is starving. The scriptures, the Word of God, the words of God are the bread of life. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And if you're not feeding your soul on the scriptures, your soul is emaciated and wasting away and starving. Now, I'm not saying you have to read 6 chapters a day, but you should read something, a chapter or a pericope. You should spend some time fellowshipping with other Christians and talking about the Word, because your soul will feed on that and you will grow in some amazing ways. Let's open our hymnals to page 359. "Alas, and did my Savior bleed?" We'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. Now we'll come to our responsive reading from Psalm 51. I'll read the dark print and you can read the red. "Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, O God of my salvation.
And my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Then will you delight in right sacrifices. Thank you. You may be seated. Now we talk a lot about Zion and Jerusalem and the walls of Jerusalem. We talked last week or the week before about what Zion means, but these images are very Jewish. Jesus was a Jew. David was a Jew. David wrote this psalm. But these images aren't relegated alone to the city of Jerusalem on a hill in Israel in the Middle East next to the Mediterranean. Jerusalem is the city of peace. That peace rests on the church. The walls of Jerusalem are those ideas, those concepts which protect and surround us. When the Lord says, don't do this, that's one of the walls around your city. Those walls protect your peace. So even though we have these images of sacrifice, of walls of Jerusalem, of the city of Zion, all of these things are important to us where we are. That a Southern Ohio kid in half a world away is loved by the King of the universe. And that these things are put in place so that we may know his love. It feels like we're just zipping through the service, doesn't it? And I'm trying to stop that. I'm trying to slow it down. And that's why I keep talking. Please forgive me. I do have this card here that I meant to read for the announcements, and I didn't. I'm not sure what it says, but it's from Karen DeWitt. It says, thank you. Dear church family, thank you all for your love, prayers, the beautiful flowers, and the most delicious food you all gave in honor of my beloved brother. You truly touched all of our families. Love the Lane family and the DeWitt family. I'll post this on the bulletin board in the back so everyone can see it. One of the things that I love about church is church is not for entertainment. I know I'm a funny guy, right? I know my jokes always land. That's two for two. I'm doing good. But I'm not, my purpose is not to entertain. Our purpose for being here is not because there's nothing good on Netflix we want to watch. Our purpose for being here is to fellowship with other Christians, to learn about God, but most importantly, to worship him and bring glory to his name. That's why when the liturgy feels stale, like it sometimes does, and I love the liturgy, I do, but sometimes I just want to jump in and say, wait a minute, we're going through this so quickly, we're doing all of this by rote, do we know why we're here? Do we realize that Jesus died on a cross because he loves you, that he came out of the grave 3 days later to show you that you would too, and that's why we're here. We're not here to listen to me tell stories, although my stories are really good. But we're here to honor the God who bought us with his own blood. So if anybody wants to stand up right now and talk and tell us what the Lord has done for you, and we're going into our prayer reports and praise. We're going into that time, you know, the thing. We're going into that time of our service. So if anyone has a testimony they'd like to share, if anyone would like to to tell what the Lord has done for you, please let me know. We'll stop and listen in and celebrate with you. Donna. Amen. Thank you. Anybody else? Has the Lord done something good for you? Yeah, Heather.
I have a very good friend of ours, Terry, who contested this as well, because of her first grandbaby 2 months early. So he's on the struggle, but he looks strong, he looks amazing, and God is blessing him. He's making progress every day. And we're just so excited. We can't wait until he's strong enough that we can all pass him around and love on it. So,
amen.
That is a true blessing this week.
Absolutely. I remember when Andrew was born, I was standing there. He had some oxygen deficiencies, and so they put him in a bubble or a helmet. And I was standing there staring at him, and it was just such a blessing, right, to just see this new life there. And I wanted to sing something, and the only song that came to my mind was "Ramblin' Man" by the Allman Brothers, and I have no idea why. But every time I hear that song on the radio, I'm standing there again in the NICU, realizing that my life had changed forever. So I don't know. I it was just a weird time. Anybody else? Yeah. Yeah, and if you want to come up and use the mic, please do.
I decided to sell my mom's house, and it's a hard decision for me to make. But before my mom passed, she said to me, "Karen, I know you and I probably are not ready to move to town yet, and we're not." So after praying, crying, thinking, I wanted to decide, okay, well, I'm going to sell my mom's house that she left to me and mom. And I said, "Well, the only way I'm going to do it is with somebody that will love it like my mom and dad did." Well, that prayer was answered. And my husband said to me, I've told this story a lot of times, but it's a truth. And my husband said to me, "When I think Greg and June Wayland would be good to buy your mom's house." And I'm like, "Oh, Mom, no, they just moved. They're not a bit yet." So I think part of January, February, somewhere when I just texted her out of the blue, and I thought, "I'm going to try it." I said, "June, I decided to sell my mom's house, and you know anybody that might be interested, let me know." She said, "Fine." The girls was playing a tournament game, I believe. Down there in the meeting, and it was cold, and she said, "I'm going to listen to the meeting, or have the kids or something, I forget." But anyway, I said, "I'm going to listen to it too." And so we listened to the ball game, and before that, when we got out of our store, just a little bit, the color got out of your store. But before that, I had come up with a number in my head, you know, what I thought I might ask it. Anyway, we listened to the game. And she texted me, "Pretty much perfectly." She said, "We want your house and we'll give you this amount." And believe it or not, it was just a penny. What was in my head? And I was sitting in the recliner and I got goosebumps as I said to Mark. I said, "Mark, I have just received the biggest blessing ever." And I said, "Okay." Simple as that. And
God, the world is easy.
So, and my mom loved to make June, well, all kinds of things because do stuff, and she would come over there and all the time, Henrietta's room or whatever, and they had all the pretty little things here there. And to think how this God's plan was so big that Mom made those islands for two in that house, and now we're there, back where they came from. So this week, Tuesday, the 15th, we sealed the deal. So it is now. She told me, she said, it'll always be the Henrietta and Joe Lane house. I'm like, no. No, it's still going to be Greg and June Wayland house. So it is officially Greg and June Wayland house. And I couldn't be any more happy. So blessed when I go by, I know Mom and Dad's house is full of love. And it's going to be well taken care of. So it's a true blessing.
Amen.
It's a blessing to all of us. But we were able to do it, and we sold our house in 4 days, and the people appreciated what we did for it. It was just meant to be.
And she's cooking a lot in the kitchen.
But this is a funny, and those of you know, Campbell Soup Woman and Grilled Cheese. I worked with a bunch of men all my life, and they would always, every morning, because men, the first thing they think about is their belly, and they'd say, Jimmy, I was married about a week. What did you fix your husband for supper last night? And I said, grilled cheese and tomato soup. And they looked at me real funny. What a wife you are. Well, the next day, Jimmy, what did you fix your husband for supper last night? I said, chicken noodle soup and grilled cheese. And they just gave me the hardest time for 32 years. I can't cook. And I called Karen and I said, you know what? We've been in here 3 months and I'm cooking all better on Henrietta's stove. Well, Greg, I'm out there. I think I am, but I don't know.
I wish she did. So I said, okay, you just carry on that tradition. Mom would be really, really happy about it.
I called Karen and said, I don't know if it's a stove or what, but I'm not learning half the stuff I used to do.
So anyway, we feel very blessed, and I love it dearly. And when I go by, I have happy thoughts.
And thank you for all your prayers. Mark Sullivan stopped me last night and said to thank you all again. And he goes, hey, you and Greg starting to flip houses with me? I said, we're done.
Thank you.
And while I'm up here, I'm going to ask for prayer. I got a call last night, all you choir members. Very sad call from Marilyn Kern. Her husband, Tom, is very bad. He's been in Columbus Hospital. They've been bringing home and awaiting tests. He just lost his twin brother. Her twin sister came home from Michigan, and she asked that we all pray hard. He's got a bunch of tests this week, but Marilyn was very upset. So she's the Clarksburg pianist that we
do. What was her last name?
Kern.
Kern. K-E-R-N family.
But while he's writing that down, what I would always tell my coworkers after that, if I told them I made grilled cheese, I would tell them I served the burnt side then.
Does anyone else have anything they'd like to share? I know it's all mornings. Yeah. Amen.
I just want to know, everybody knows that I give God all that privilege.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. Are there any others?
Oh, I have another praise.
June.
We have a new family member, too, born 2 weeks ago on Monday. Zoe Irene, named after my mom. Allison and Josie had a little baby girl, so, and she's doing great, and they are, too. So.
That's wonderful. Thank you. Anyone else? It's good that we come together to be mutually encouraged by these stories, to tell one another what the Lord has done in our lives, because sometimes the world is such a dark place that we need to see some light. And that's one of the reasons I love coming to church. Are there any other prayer requests or praise reports? If you something struck you and you want to pop up and talk, I'd be happy to hear you. But are there any other prayer requests or praise reports?
It's still waiting on doctors. The doctor's about the sinus mask. He's seen a doctor, but he didn't. Everybody knows how it is. Good job.
Yeah, my grandfather used to sit all the way across the living room from the TV. He could hear every gunshot in those cowboy movies, but he couldn't hear Grandma say anything. Yes. Absolutely. Any others? Prayer requests, praise reports? If not, let's go before the throne. Blessed and holy Lord, we bathe so often in your goodness that we forget we are wet. Father, we bask in your glory. We come to worship you because you are worthy. You are good and holy and true and just and righteous and kind and loving. And Father, we stand amazed who and what you are. Father, we lift hands of praise. We lift voices of song. We lift hearts of worship to you because you are worthy. There is none like you. There is none beside you. Father, we enter your courts with thanksgiving. We enter your courts with praise. Because we see, Lord, we see the good that you have done. We see the wonderful deeds that you have wrought in our own lives. We see the stories in the scriptures. We hear the tale of Jesus and his cross and the stone that rolled away. Father, we know that you have done these things for us, that you didn't need them, but that we did. That in your grace, in your mercy, in your wonderful self, we find hope. In you, Father, and in you alone, we find our purpose. In you, Lord, and in you alone, we live and move and have our being. And so, Father, the only reasonable response is worship. Father, we come into your house this morning to worship you, to express our love, to express our gratitude, to meet with you in this holy place, and to bow before you. Blessed Father, we have sinned against heaven and against our fellow man. We have done those things we should not have done, and we have left undone those things we should have accomplished, and there is within us no peace. But Father, you tell us in your scriptures that if we confess our sins, you are faithful, you are just, you will forgive us our trespasses and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Father, in these next few moments, in the privacy of our own hearts, in this holy place, in your presence, we make our confession before you. So, Father, through our confession and through the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, the Anointed One, we are forgiven. And it is truly marvelous in our sight. Now, Father, as a righteous and a redeemed people, we stand before you. We lift before you, Father, those requests we have spoken this morning and also those we have kept hidden in our hearts. Father, we ask that you would be with the Kern family. Lord, we ask your hand of blessing and healing on Dick. Father, we ask that you would watch over our band, our students, the staff, and administrators. Father, we ask that you would protect them through the good work that you have called them to do, that their joy would bring glory to your name. Father, we ask your blessing on our nation and its leaders. Lord, we ask that you would give them wisdom and courage and strength to do what is right in your eyes, that our nation might once again be a shining city set upon a hill, proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ to a dark and hurting world. Also, Father, we ask your blessing on this church, on Frankfort United Methodist Church, on the building, on the premises, on the people in the pews. Father, we ask that you would use us to bring glory to your name, that the word of the Lord would truly go forth from this place, and that souls would be brought to the altar of Jesus Christ. Now, Father, as we go into the remainder of our service, we ask that you would be with us. We ask, Lord, that you would open our ears and loose our tongues and soften our hearts, that we might know and speak and hear the wonderful, holy truths of your scripture. These things we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, the Anointed One, who himself has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not unto temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. The offering plates are in the back. Please partner. If you would like to give, please partner with the... I don't know why this is so hard. It always is. And I know that it's important. I know that this church couldn't survive. It couldn't continue doing what it does without your gifts. I had a church die out from under me. My first church just closed because we didn't have enough people and enough money coming in. And I would hate to see this church go that way. I'm not trying to threaten anybody. It's uncomfortable I guess I'm thinking of it wrong. I'm thinking of it as me asking you for money, and I'm not doing that. This is God asking all of us to give back a portion of what he has given us. And in the end, it's all his. So if you would like to partner with the work this church is doing, please leave your gifts as you come or as you go, and the Lord will bless you for it. Let's open our Bibles one more time to Matthew chapter 4, and we will begin at verse 1. Now, I know this is a sermon series, and I know that I preached on the first temptation 2 weeks ago and the second temptation last week, and we read this text then as well. We're going to read it again because there's some stuff here that we need to see. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 1, if you could please, let's rise for the reading of Scripture. Matthew 4 and 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. The word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you. You may be seated. Would you bow your hearts with me, please, for just a moment? Blessed Father, in these next few moments, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Thank you. Now, for the last couple of weeks, we've been exploring the first and second temptations of Christ immediately following his baptism by John. And he went out into the desert to fast. With the first temptation, we explored the purpose of Christ going into the wilderness in the first place. That was to redeem the Exodus event. One day in the desert, for every year the Hebrews were condemned to spend there. Jesus went into the desert to redeem the wilderness wanderings under Moses. So when the devil tempted him, saying, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread," Jesus responded by quoting from Deuteronomy, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Again, the devil tempted him, taking him to the pinnacle of a temple and saying, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down." And Jesus responded again, "It is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Now, twice the devil has tempted him to prove not only his power, but his identity. If you are the Son of God. Twice, Jesus had responded in obedience and humility. Twice, Jesus had quoted from Deuteronomy to defeat Satan. Our sermon last week spent a good bit of time exploring the concept of humility and what humility is, and how Jesus, who is God incarnate, can still be humble. Before we dig too deeply into the third temptation, then, we should look at the concept of temptation itself and see what the Bible has to say about it. Linguistically, the idea of temptation is tied to the concept of testing. Now, I could have taken you through the Greek and the Hebrew to show that, but I thought you would appreciate it if I didn't. I am on it today. Man, there's some humility for you. That is that when you are being tempted, often there is some sort of a test involved. For example, let's suppose someone has decided to lose weight, right? And let's suppose that someone has a particular fondness for Snickers bars and A&W root beer. That's oddly specific, I know, but it's a fictional example. When our hypothetical person who has decided to lose weight finds himself in a place where root beer and Snickers are sold, he will often find himself being tempted or tested. Sometimes he will do well and overcome the temptation, and sometimes he will fail the test. The first occurrence of the word test in the Bible, then, is in Genesis chapter 22. Verse 1 says, "After these things, God tested Abraham, and he said to him, 'Abraham,' and he said, 'Here I am.'" Now, we all know this particular story. This is the story of the binding of Isaac, the Akedah, the Holy of Holies of the Old Testament, where Abraham takes his son to the same mountain on which Christ was crucified and begins to offer him up as a sacrifice to God. Now, interestingly, the Hebrew word for testing does not appear at any point before this in the Bible. If you read through the account of the serpent tempting Eve, not once does it use this word, even though it seems like it should. In fact, God waits 22 chapters to use this word. And the first place he uses the word test is one sentence away from the first place he uses the word love. I don't know what you're going to do with that, but I found that fascinating. Why does God test us? Testing is intrinsically tied to love. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 6 says that for the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. So if you find yourself being disciplined by God, be grateful. It's a sign of his love. The idea appears several times in the Bible in both the Old and New Testaments, in places like Psalm 94:12 and Revelation 3:19. But in our Genesis 22 package, we see God a passage. We see God testing Abraham by commanding him to take his son to the mountain and sacrifice him there. And you know the story, and if you don't, it's fascinating. Go read Genesis 22. But why does God test Abraham? Does God not know how Abraham will respond? Of course he does. He's God. So why test him? God tests Abraham not because God needs to learn anything, but because Abraham does. God wants to show Abraham that he is able, he, Abraham, is able to stand up in the face of trials and trouble. Abraham is changed by the trial, but the change is that he knows he can do what the Lord has called him to. Abraham's faith is refined, made pure in the testing, because God shows himself trustworthy. A temptation, then, is a test which shows us what is within us. And all too often, what is within us is Snickers and root beer. Jeremiah 9:7 says, "Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, I will refine them and test them, for what else can I do because of my people?" Isaiah 48:10-11, we find, "See, I have refined you, though not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction. For my own sake, I do this. How can I let myself be defamed? I will not yield my glory to another." We find the same idea in Proverbs 17:3, which reads, "The crucible is for silver, and the furnace is for gold, and the Lord tests hearts." We find the refiner's fire in the New Testament also. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning at verse 12, Paul says, "Now if anyone builds on a foundation of gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. The work that anyone has built on the foundation, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burnt up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire." Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw. What is your foundation made of? Because a fire will come and test it. What happens to gold or silver or precious stones when you put them in fire? Nothing. Gold and silver will become more pure through the fire, but wood, hay, and straw will be consumed. The tests we encounter in life are frequently spoken of in terms of refining. Now, I've seen this word several times in my preparation for the sermon, so I thought, well, let me find out what refining is. So I did what any reasonable person would do. I did a YouTube search for refining, and I found this amazing video of a man who was going to refine old film waste. When you take pictures or shoot movies on film, part of the chemical that keeps the picture on the film is silver. And so he thought what he would do is take this old film waste and refine it. Now here you can see, and I probably just see blackness in there. It's nasty. When I looked in that bucket the first time, I saw what came to mind was an overflowing septic tank. Mud mixed with filth. That's what it looks like. I don't know what it smells like, but that's what it looks like. This horrible, nasty, ugly blackness. Anyway, if you gather enough of this film stuff, and you're smart like this guy was, you can separate the silver from the mess. Next slide. Previous slide. So this slide is a bucket filled with the film waste. When I first saw it, it looked irredeemable. It's just trash. But then I noticed that the video was 25 minutes long. This was not going to be a quick bit of research. The fellow took the film waste and he put it into this crucible, which we see here. Good. Next slide. He put the crucible into a furnace and heated it very, very hot. Then he poured the resultant molten liquid into a mold to cool. The mold you can see at the bottom here. Go back one. The mold you can see at the bottom here is pyramid shaped. The heavier things will fall to the bottom of the liquid and the lighter things will rise to the top. Now, letting it cool, he dumped the mold and separated the silver from the rest of the material. Here, this is what resulted after it all cooled. And you can see he's swinging a hammer at the tip there. Next slide. Over here, in the corner there, and that's the best image I could get of it, was this little tiny pyramid of stuff that broke off. Everything else is waste. Everything else is garbage that he's just going to throw away. But there's this little tiny pyramid of stuff. And I thought, well, that's excellent. That's wonderful. We have refined silver. But does that look silver to anybody? No. And I wish it did. For a lot of reasons, I wish it did. There were more things to do. You see, the metal chunk he pulled out of the mold was partly made of iron also. Iron is very heavy and it sinks. So he tried something else to separate the iron from the silver, and that failed entirely. And then he tries a third technique, which involves more time in the crucible, more time in the furnace. It didn't work either. And at the 17-minute mark on the video slide, he takes his kiln apart and remakes the base at the bottom of his kiln. He fashions this mound of concrete powder, dry concrete powder, and then he rebuilds the kiln around it, and he puts his chunk of blackness into a hole that he digs out in this mound of concrete powder, and he heats it up again to 1700 degrees. He brings it again to a molten state, and finally, the iron and the silver separate. Slide. And he comes up with this small wafer of silver. Yay! Right? No. No, not yet. Because when he turns it over, it's still fused with iron and other chemicals, borax and stuff that I've never heard of, and bits of the concrete powder. So he adds more chemicals. He goes back to the kiln for another round of extreme temperatures. And finally, he ends up with this. Next slide. This pyramid of pure silver. I don't know if you can see it. There's the scale there. But then in his hand, you can see the silver that has been purified. It's about 750 grams of pure silver, which is finally free of the lead and the iron and the waste from the film. Next slide. Here we can see the before and the after images. The before, that ugly mess in the bottom of this bucket. The after image, this beautiful, refined pyramid of pure silver. Over and over again, the Bible uses this image of refining for the testing of God's people. Now, let me break away from my notes here and say that I really wanted the first product to be refined pure silver. I really did. Because the fact that he has to go back to the kiln again and again and again, the fact that he has to hammer it and beat it with chemicals and acid, the fact that he pours it with through water to extrude it into... This is why God uses this image of the refining fire for our lives. Because it's a long process. It's a very long and painful process. Again, Proverbs chapter 17 and verse 3 reads, "The crucible is for silver and the furnace is for gold, and the Lord tests hearts." Why are we tempted? Why are we tested? Because, dearly beloved, we are being refined. Through a long and difficult process, the Lord is removing impurities from our hearts. And just like the silver didn't want to give up the iron, there are things in my heart that I don't want to get rid of. There are things in my heart that have been there for so long that I feel like I would be losing an arm to get rid of them. It would be like losing an eye or a hand. And I know a preacher who talked about losing eyes and hands. The Lord is cleansing us from those things which keep us from being what we ought to be. From those impurities which make us less than fit for His service. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 6 reads, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. The tested genuineness of your faith, which is more precious than gold. This kind of testing shows you what is in you when all the mess of the world is burned away. Because when you come through, when by the grace of God you come through your trials, you will be made fit for the Master's service. Now, in theological terms, we call this process sanctification. It is our continual pressing onward toward holiness. When I was going through the explanation of the video, it felt a bit tedious, didn't it? Why is the pastor talking about this? I couldn't care less. Long-winded explanations of things you've never been interested in, at times seemingly pointless, entirely unrelated to anything you came to church to hear about. But every step of the refining process is necessary to produce the desired result, the pure result. It does us no good to skip parts of the process. As much as we may wish we could, as much as we may plead with God to take away these tests, and we are right to do so, even Jesus in the garden prayed, "If it be possible, let this cup pass from me." But we must, as he did, follow that prayer with, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." Now, with that understanding of testing, let's start the sermon. Let's look at Matthew chapter 4 in verse 1. Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. I've read this verse every week for the last 3 weeks, but have we heard it? We've never stopped to talk about what it says. Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Who took Jesus to where Satan was? The Spirit of God. Why was Jesus led into the wilderness by the Spirit? So that he may be tempted. God is putting his own Son into the refiner's fire here. Now, one of the things I love about Christianity, as opposed to all other religions, is that we do not worship a God who is distant. The Hindus worship 360 million gods. Those gods are distant. They're far away. They don't come here. They don't involve themselves in the affairs of men. Now, I'm not saying these gods are real. I'm saying this is what the Hindus believe. These gods have never been hungry or tired. They've never been tempted. Similarly, the Muslims who worship only one God, they argue that he cannot enter into his creation because creation itself is evil and Allah couldn't enter into that which is evil. Allah sits on his throne, which they also constantly argue about, somewhere far away and looks as if through a telescope at the world. The God of the Muslims has never known what it means to be cold or to thirst or to be tempted. And this is one of the very many reasons why this passage in Mark is so very, very precious. Dearly beloved, when you go through trials, when you face temptation, when you find yourself in the refiner's fire, your God is not only there with you, but has experienced these things in every way that you have, physically, as a person. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace, and to help us in time of need. That is, our God knows firsthand what we're going through. He's been sunburned. He's been thirsty. He knows hunger. He knows pain. Matthew chapter 4, beginning at verse 8. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, 'You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve.'" Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. Let me make you a deal, every one of you. I am trying to get people to serve on the board of the church, right? And we've got some people who've done their time and they're ready to leave the board. We need new people to step up and replace them. Everyone who comes to the next board meeting, I will personally buy you a Lamborghini. What? You get to pick the color. I will personally deliver it the day after the board meeting. All right. So, by show of hands, who here is tempted to come to the next board meeting? One person, and she's not even on the board. The people on the board didn't raise their hands. Why is that not tempting for you? Do you know what a Lamborghini is? I mean, that's an awesome, beautiful car. And even if you don't want to drive it, you can sell it for $500,000. Nobody? Why is that not tempting to you? Because you know what I make. You know there is no way I could possibly afford a single Lamborghini, let alone a dozen of them. I can't keep up my end of the bargain, so you're not tempted to take me up on it. It is the same way here with this third temptation of Christ. It would not be a temptation at all if Satan could not deliver on his promise. And this is the terrifying thing, dearly beloved. What is Satan offering Jesus? All the kingdoms of the world. Not just the ones in Judea. Not just the ones near the mountain they could see. China. America. Great Britain. Rome. All of those kingdoms which have stood, have risen, have fallen, and which are yet to arise, Satan offers to Jesus. And Jesus does not laugh at him. Satan has the ability to give him these things. Because all of these things belong to Satan. Notice that there's no more appealing to Christ's humility here. If you are the Son of God, Satan doesn't try to play on Jesus' pride. Instead, he just makes a straightforward offer. I will give you what I have if you kneel before me. Christ came to redeem mankind. Satan is here offering him all of mankind on a silver platter wrapped up with a bow. All Jesus has to do is bow down and worship him. What is it that Satan wants in this exchange? He wants God to kneel before him. Satan is demanding to be exalted over the Most High. It's what he's always wanted. Really, the only thing he's ever wanted, to be greater than God. This is why Satan was cast like lightning from the heavens. In this final temptation, then, if Jesus gives in, Satan wins. And so Satan lays all of his cards on the table. I will give you the entire world and all of its people if you will make me God over you. Jesus was born in a stable to a virgin girl who was not yet wed. His mission, his great purpose, was the cross. At his trial, Jesus says, "For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Satan is offering Jesus a way to rule the world without the cross. And that Jesus knows that he's going to the cross, and we know from John 17 that Jesus is terrified of the cross. "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." He sweat great drops of blood. He was in such stress, such terror, such pain and anguish, knowing what was coming, that his heart rate was so elevated, the capillaries, the tiny blood vessels in the surface of his skin exploded from the pressure, and the blood leaked out through the pores of his body. This is a medical condition. We know about this. This happens. Jesus sweat drops of blood in his anguish at the cross. And here, Satan is saying, "You don't have to do that. Got you. I'll take care of you. Bend the knee." I can't imagine the pressure. I can't imagine the terror. I can't imagine what Jesus went through. And this, I think, is why Jesus responds in anger for the first time in these temptations. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 10, "Then Jesus said to him, 'Be gone, Satan. Get out of here. Go away. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve.'" The scripture you have in your heart is the weapon you use to survive the crucible of temptation. The scripture is how we know God and how we know what God desires. In Ephesians chapter 6, Paul says that the scripture is our sword. It is how we defeat those temptations which come against us. In the end, temptations should drive us into our Bibles. We either stand on the word of God, as Christ does in these three temptations, or we fall. Now, do you have enough scripture in your heart to stand? How much scripture do you have? How big, how solid is the platform upon which you stand? Do you have enough scripture to stand against the temptations that come in your life? And if not, dearly beloved, what are you going to do about it? Study the word. Memorize scripture. Meditate on his holy precepts. And in doing so, honor the God who bought you with his own blood. Amen. Let's bow our hearts. Blessed Father, we thank you for the rock foundation of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the scripture, our sword against the temptations of the world. Father, we ask that you would give us a heart, give us a desire to know Scripture, and through Scripture, Lord, to know you. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Let's turn in our hymnals, please, to page 504, The Old Rugged Cross. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. The cross of Christ is the central event in all of human history. It is the most important thing that has ever happened or ever will happen. With his own blood, God purchased you and me. He redeemed us and made us whole. And that is good news indeed. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give unto you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
okay?